I have to say, this is going to sound strange. There's one thing I appreciated about the Bish. He didn't really dodge the questions. Mm. Like he didn't. I mean, they weren't particularly. I didn't like the answers, but at least he didn't dodge the questions as much as many of his contemporaries do. So I'll give him at least a thanks for engaging. Didn't like the engagement, but thanks for engaging. Jack Tame asks him a question about referencing emergency housing as being a blight, ending the blight of emergency housing. And this turns into a strange circular conversation where National basically says, when beneficiaries get to the end of what we think is acceptable, they're going to have to move in with friends and family, to which Jack Tame points out several times, but if they could move in with friends and family, they wouldn't get emergency housing. Because that's like, can you go stay with friends and family? No, we can't. Okay, we'll find you emergency housing. And they're saying if that doesn't work for them, they can find. So it's a strange circular conversation. But Jack does really well at cutting through the bullshit. Let's have a look.
You said this week you want to end the blight that is emergency housing. That was the word you chose. And part of that means increasing scrutiny of those who are applying for emergency housing grants. What evidence do you have that undeserving people are accessing emergency housing grants at the moment?
Yeah, so for us, fundamentally, it's about rights and responsibilities. So obviously, there will always be a place for the government to provide emergency housing for people who need it. When it started, and it started life under the last National government in 2016, 2017, it started life as a short-term measure. You know, the government gives you a grant, a voucher,
sure.
you take it.
So my question then, so what evidence do you have that undeserving people are accessing those grants at the moment?
Anecdotal feedback from the community and from MSD.
Yeah, no, it's a terrible answer, but like I'm saying, he answered it. I mean, like, I don't like the answer, but at least he didn't go round in circles. I'm not supporting his position, but I am going, it's a terrible answer, but he answered it.
Yeah, but also from
the community. Anecdotal feedback?
Yeah, well, look, this is a tough area, right? This is a really, really tough area. We've had advice from...
So what percentage of emergency housing grants are denied at the moment? Do you know that?
Not many. From memory, in the last year, about 2,500, 2,600, something like that, over
that's
the over 100,000.
Yeah, but that is still quite a few, isn't it?
Well, in relation to the overall number of 100,000, 120,000 grants given, you know, 3,000 families there right now. Numbers have come back a bit recently, but 3,000 families, average length of stay is 26 weeks. Not many are declined. We're just saying to MSD, yep, you should have the support available if people need it. But you do need to ask a few questions of people, like, are there other places you can stay? Going to a motel should not be the kind of first choice for people who need support.
Do you not think that MSD asks that at the moment?
They do, technically. we're asking them to really invigilate people a bit more to make sure that we're providing taxpayer support to people who really need support.
You've said that you won't be supporting people who have, quote, unreasonably contributed to their emergency housing need. What does that mean?
Now, this is a terrible answer. I know he's about to answer, but I'll explain it to you. The way that was set up, it sounds like they were saying something outside of emergency housing, but he actually says if they damage the hotel room, they'll then have to go live with friends and family, which is where this, which means actually they're not responsible for being there because they're already there. So it seems that even the Bish doesn't quite understand the policy, because if it's about if they've contributed to it, that would appear to me to be something they've done before they get emergency housing. But the Bish says it's whilst they've got emergency housing, so they're already having it. So what have they contributed more to being a part of emergency housing when they're already in emergency housing? It's most peculiar.
Unfortunately, there are a group of people who abuse their rights and privileges. When it comes to emergency housing, they trash the place, for example, and people watching.
This is people who are applying for grants in the first place, and if they've unreasonably contributed to their emergency housing need,
people have to reapply, right? That's the thing is, people often the grants are for, say, a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks. People have to reapply.
And you've shortened that window now, too.
And we're going to shorten that window, yes.
So just to be clear, though, so if someone has unreasonably contributed to their emergency housing need, you're talking about someone who's already in emergency housing or in social housing and has trashed the place.
Yeah, I mean, unfortunately, there are a group of people.
So no one's in favour of people trashing motel rooms, but how have they contributed to being in that motel room, after they get put in it and they trash it? That's not contributing them to being in emergency housing because they're already in it. So I wonder, I'm almost being a bit generous here, I wonder if the Bish has got this wrong, which he shouldn't have, because it doesn't make any logical sense. He's saying, if you have contributed to being in emergency housing by messing up the emergency housing you're already in, then you won't be able to apply to be in emergency housing. It's just, it's a strange thing.
It's a dumb answer. Like, oh God, I'm having to interpret National Party policy. Like, surely the answer here is what he means is you were in a private rental and you didn't pay rent, or you got thrown out or evicted, and you unreasonably contributed to that circumstance, then we don't necessarily have to give you emergency housing. That's what he's meaning to say, I guess.
Well, maybe, because he gets four or five chances and he keeps going back. Jack actually says, so you're talking about people in emergency, and he goes, yep. So this is why I'm like, he has to be pretty stupid to miss the direct questions that Jack's answering him. If it's like someone who has wasted all their money at Sky City or something, so they've contributed to having no money, so therefore they need emergency housing, or they haven't paid their rent for 3 months, so they've contributed to it, so they then have emergency housing. Whereas that's not the question, and Bishop's answered it by saying this is about people already in emergency housing. It's quite bizarre. We'll play a bit more, because it does get more circular.
Who do that, and there'll be people watching this morning who will have seen that in their own communities, and it's tragic. But the taxpayer at some point has to say, look, we're not just going to keep funding you to trash motel rooms and live in squalor. I don't think New Zealanders would accept that.
So where do those people go?
Great question.
Well, ultimately, they will have to go and bunk with friends and family. And that's what some people do now.
But wouldn't they have done that when MSD had given them the greater scrutiny that you're introducing?
Well, theoretically.
So to get emergency housing, you basically have to have no friends and family to bunk with. So now we're saying, if we kick you out of emergency housing, you can go and bunk with friends and family, which they don't have, because they had to not have them to get emergency housing. And this is where it goes round and round and round.
Yeah, and hope, you know, that's what we want to try and get to.
So they only get emergency housing if they don't have anyone to stay with.
We want to make it genuinely a last resort. We want to make sure.
So the frustration in Bish's voice is he going, we're trying to make this a last resort, but we can't figure out how. That's basically what he's saying. Because it seems that what he's saying is it already is a last resort. So this is already a last resort. You have to not be able to go stay with friends and family. This has to be the last resort. And Nationals come in going, we've got to make this the last resort. It already is the last resort. Well, we're going to make it harder anyway. So then it appears like it's even the last resort, because everything he's saying makes no sense. Because you can't go and stay with friends and family to get emergency housing, but if they kick you out of emergency housing, you have to go with friends and family that you can't do. It doesn't make any sense at all. Round and round and round and round and round and round.
Jack goes, where do these people go? And I feel like that big sigh before the Bish answered was, look, Jack, we don't care.
Yeah.
We don't care where they go.
Or we don't want know.
We want them off our lists.
Yep.
We don't want to be paying for this. So maybe if they just go and camp out under a bridge or down by the river, or next to the oval, down by the motorway, and eventually the problem will attrit itself out of the books.
Yeah.
Do you get me, Jack?
Yeah.
Light up my thinking cigarette, and away we go.
We're accessing emergency housing. It's there as the final port of call for people who actually need it.
And that's how it started, but it's grown into this giant industry. Question is, what happens to those people who, for whom it is a last resort, who you say have unreasonably contributed to their emergency housing need by trashing it, for example?
There'll always be support for people who need it. The New Zealand government is not going to sit around.
That's not really what you're saying.
I get that, but you're saying that people who don't respect the roof over their heads, funded by the taxpayer, should not expect to continue having that support. So my question is, where do those people go?
At the most basic.
So Bishop says we will always be there to support some people, but what about those people that you're throwing out? Again, don't really know how to answer that, because it doesn't make sense, and I know it doesn't in my head.
Level, there may well be people who miss out on emergency housing support. We are tightening the eligibility.
And so where do they go?
Well, they will have to find an alternative place to stay. But the taxpayer at some point has to say,
what's an alternative
we're not funding
place to stay?
Your bad lifestyle choices.
I understand. What's an alternative place to stay?
Friends and family. That's what people do now, and that option becomes
available. They only get emergency housing if they don't have friends or family? That's the scrutiny that you're introducing.
Well, not necessarily. At the moment, the status quo. These changes
are happening. We're going around in circles.
Yes, we are, but these changes are happening contemporaneously.
Well, these are the rules and settings that you are applying.
Unbelievable. There you
go. Yeah, so I've got another 2-minute clip to play from this as well, but anything you want to jump in on that? So it's such a weak argument, and I do feel like they've kind of gone, you know, in the back room, they've made up these policies and they've written them out, and they're like, oh, these will sell well, and this will be a good bumper sticker, and this will be a good headline. Now we need to implement it to make this like the last resort. Well, it already is the last resort. Shit. How can we reword it to make it sound like it's not the last resort? Oh, I know, if they've contributed to themselves. But that means they're already in housing. Oh, shit. It just goes round and round and round and round and round.
I've mentioned before that National are short-term thinkers.
Yep.
They think one step, right? And they're talking to their base, and they're doing it based on vibes and all of that stuff. And I see that there's a couple of people in the chat talking about, well, maybe they don't deserve it, and maybe they should get a job and stop smoking and drinking and all of this sort of stuff. It's all short-term thinking when you're thinking of that. The long-term thinking is these people might have kids, and we want to get kids out of this fucking loop that their parents have been put in.
Yeah.
And we do that by making sure that they're healthy and fed and housed and going to school. And that's all you can do. There's other parts of life that might shit on them and it might not work. But one of the things that is very, very clear to me is that if you are at the bottom and the government is pointing at you and going, you're on the bottom and we're going to make it harder. We're going to make sure that you only have access to this for a very short amount of time. We're going to quiz you about why your friends and family can't put you up. Because when you're on the bottom, chances are so are your friends.
Yeah, yeah.
And what do we know about people that are on the bottom? They might be a family of 8. In a 2-bedroom house, because that's all that they can afford in this fucking housing market, or it's all that MSD has been able to find them as far as social housing goes. So there's no room for them, right? So it's a self-fulfilling prophecy.
Yeah,
I can't stay with any of my friends because they have no room. It's not like, oh yeah, I could ask my mate who has the multi-million-dollar mansion on the North Shore. I could go and stay in his pool house. It's just bullshit. And he is right. There is always going to be a need for emergency housing. There shouldn't be very many people accessing it because we have a proper network of social housing, more permanent social housing, where people can go, this is my home. I can take pride in this. My kid can go to the school that's nearby. There are services nearby. My job is nearby, or I have the ability to get a job. Every time we make those things harder, and it can be, it's not just social housing, it's affordable housing. We know our rental market is jacked. And the only way to bring that down is to add more houses. And if there was an incentive for investors to go and build more affordable housing, if there was tax benefits for that, for investing in that sort of thing rather than investing on other people paying off your mortgage, then I'd be all for it. But they won't do that because there's people that have 25 rentals, 50 rentals, and if we add more houses to the housing market, then their portfolios and their investments lose value. They lose the capital gains. And they'll be very big mad. And they won't be happy with their vote. So we can't do that. So these guys are trying to solve a problem that they don't want to solve.
Yeah.
And the only option that they've got is to be mean, to be harder, to be less caring about people who have less resources to do anything about it.
We'll go on to another part of the story because this interview was, I think, it was over half an hour all up, and there's a lot of information that we can't do it all, obviously, but this was a part of the conversation that they talked about. Will housing be more lucrative for investors with this new interest deductibility coming in? Would it be more, will it be a better investment? Will it attract more investors to the to the investment of being landlords. Mm. I don't think it gets asked in this, but I think it's been asked numerous times elsewhere, is like, so then what happens when the first time homeowner turns up? Now, if it's more attractive to investors, now they've got other first home buyers and 20 investors wanting to buy the property as well. What does that do to the price and availability to first time house buyers, for example?
You have set some relatively loose targets for housing affordability over the long term. What advice have you had about the impact of your landlord tax cuts on house prices?
Well, the impact, the advice we've had in relation to rent affordability is that it puts downward pressure on
rents.
House
prices, though, not rents, house prices.
I haven't had specific advice on house price.
See, again, he answered the question. Like, I'm just being fair and saying a lot of the politicians that have been coming in from Mike would go round and round in circles. He just says we haven't had that, which I think is something we have to respect and thank them for doing. At least he's not bullshitting people. It's not good that he hasn't had that advice, but at least he's just answered that question.
Yeah.
The impact on house prices.
You have no advice on what those big changes will do to house prices.
Well, I haven't had specific advice on that.
Shouldn't you have had advice on that?
Well, the way the paper flow works is it's essentially a finance paper. So I haven't had, as housing minister, specific advice about that. I have seen advice around removing the, or bringing back interest deductibility for landlords. Will put downward pressure on rents.
On rents.
And that's important.
Just remember though as well, downward pressure doesn't mean rents declining. Downward pressure could also just be, yeah, we could decline, we could reduce our rent if we wanted to, but we're not going to. Downward pressure is no guarantees of rent going down. No matter how much they say downward pressure, doesn't mean rents will go down. Also, if you flip, you know, how you flip a coin, equal and opposite is often true as well, right? So downward pressure, the equal and opposite to that is probably more profit. Downward pressure, more profit, depending on which side you want to look at it.
Important, because rental affordability is a big driver of the wait list.
So what would be your expectation as to what it'll do to house prices? You think it'll bring rents down, but what will it do to house prices?
Well, the ultimate driver of house prices is supply and demand of housing. And
so you don't think that changing this policy will have any impact?
Well, I think it will potentially incentivise more residential construction for the purpose of rental properties. That is ultimately a good thing for rental affordability, and that's what I'm very focused on.
Won't it also just incentivize housing as an investment?
Yes.
Well, ultimately what we want to do across the housing, our housing system.
Will it incentivize housing as an investment class?
I don't believe so.
Bullshit.
Because what we're doing is returning to basic principles of tax law, which is that interest is an expense that you can deduct against your income.
I understand the changes. Is it more lucrative for landlords to have interest deductibility in place or not to have it in place?
Well, clearly it is better for landlords to have interest.
Well done, Jack.
Yeah, masterful question.
Well done, Jack. So he's just said it won't be any more interested. Investors won't be any more interested. Will it be better or worse for landlords? Will it all be better? Well done, sir. Golf clap.
Deductibility in place, and that is why we think that's partly
So this change makes housing as an investment class more lucrative.
It's partly why we want to do it, because we need mum and dad landlords in the market.
And now he's just gone into, from saying it wouldn't, why we want to do it is to get more people in there.
You got me. You got me, bro.
Yeah, you got him.
Anyway,
right.
Now
a lot of them have exited the market post the interest deductibility changes.
So, you would accept then that it makes it more lucrative as an investment class?
Well, yes, on the margins, yes.
There you go. And there was one other thing that they talked about in this, and I'm not going to play the bit, I don't actually have it queued up anyway, is that Jack asked him about their targets for affordable housing when it comes to purchasing. And right now it's something like 6 to 7 times the average household income is the average price. Average household income right now is $126,000. That's household, remember, make that clear. It's not just one person's income, household income. And he said they wanted to get it 3 to 5 times the average household income. That means he's trying to pull the wool over our eyes by saying they would like to get prices of houses to between $378,000 and $630,000. That's their objective. That's 3 to 5 times the average household income. Now, there's another part of this, which I know most of you and most of us probably won't care about, which is, so if you do drop 30% of the price of houses, how many people go bankrupt who have then got mortgages more than what their houses are worth? They got to at least consider that as well. But who honestly believes that they're going to be able to get the average house price down to something like $380,000? They won't be able to, but neither do they want to, Chewy. It's just all words.
If the average house price went down that much, there'd be people losing their fucking minds. The guys that have paid $6, $7, $8, $9, $1.4 million on their house, and now the value's tanked. Like, we've had over 40 years now of the sensible investment is property. It always goes up. There's all of these deductibilities that you can get. You can get someone in and they pay your mortgage for you. It's free money. And if you want a nice retirement, that's what you've got to do. And this is something that we know here doesn't work, and it hasn't worked overseas as well. It's cooked every housing market that it's been deployed in. I'm specifically talking about here, Australia, the UK, the US. It is fucked. Yeah. Like, you have people that have more cash flow or more equity just hoover up more and more property, and they completely screw the market. But it takes money away from investing in businesses. Traditionally, that's been the investment, right? There's someone with a good idea and they want money, and they promise that they'll give that money back and more once the idea works. And you get businesses, you get inventions, you get manufacturing, you get all of these good things that really keep an economy humming. Here in New Zealand, our economy is mainly based off selling old houses to one another.